Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, everyone. I hope everything is well for you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of you. Jazakallah khairan again for coming for this beautiful session, which is Al-Fitan wal-Balaya wal-Mihan wal-Razaya wa Fawaidul Balwa wal-Mihan. So the title of our, book, which is the book of Al-Izz, Abdul Aziz ibn Abdul Salam, right? Who is known as Imam al-Madhabain, who is the Imam of two madhabs, mashallah, two schools of thought. And that in itself is an achievement. If it was only that, that would be enough. But subhanAllah, we find this great Imam, mashallah, what a great person he is. So we've gone through a lot, mashallah, so far. We've gone through the different virtues and the different maratib of Fawaidul Balwa, the virtues of Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad, the virtues of, going through difficulty. So today we're going to carry on with the list, and inshallah ta'ala, we will, continue with the list. So the next one on the list is al-inabatu ila Allahi wal-iqbalu alayh. So to have this inaba, turning back towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We get woken up by these problems. When disasters happen to us, it's a wake up. It's sort of like, maybe I should go back towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Did I do something wrong? And that is the nafs al-lawwama. The person, when they begin to start increasing in their sacrifice, and they start to increase in terms of getting close towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they begin to develop this love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, because we are such that we make mistakes, fina ayyub walin nasi ayyun. Fina ayyub walin nasi ayyun. That, people, there are other people that are around us. But, because we have faults, they have eyes. So they have eyes and we have faults, right? And so because of that, there is a little bit of, this way, that way, there is a little bit of, every time something happens, you sort of like, people look at you like, okay, you did this wrong, you did that wrong. So fina ayyub walin nasi ayyun, that we have faults, right? And people have eyes. It's going to happen. But when a person gets to the nafs al-lawwama stage, a person realizes that when they do something wrong in their lives, right? They do something wrong, and then they remind themselves that, subhanallah, like, what did I do? Did I step on someone? And subhanAllah, I had a teacher who was very mindful of this. And he used to think back very mindfully, did I step on someone's toes? And then he would go back to this person and he would seek forgiveness from this very, just in case, he doesn't know whether he did something wrong. And he was very mindful. So al-inabatu ila Allah. So you turn towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-inabatu ila Allah ta'ala alayhi. And وَإِذَا مَسَّ الْإِنسَانُ الضُّرُّ دَعَى رَبَّهُ مُنِيبًا إِلَيْهِ. When a person receives some difficulty happens in that person's life, دَعَى رَبَّهُ مُنِيبًا إِلَيْهِ. The person has this inaba towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This person has this thing where, okay, look, I'm doing something wrong. And I need to turn back towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So subhanAllah, this is the door that is open for us. And this happens as a result of calamity and disasters. They wake us up, And I think all of us are asking ourselves that question now, especially at this time. What did we do that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala closed the door in the masjid for us? What did we do? The imam is asking, the musallis are asking. What did we do? Did we do something wrong? Okay, we understand COVID-19, everything, but was there something we did wrong? The whole life is, the whole world's been put on hold. So it's like an inaba time. Maybe we didn't. Maybe this is just a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Maybe everything is just really positive. But it's a pause. Like, okay, this is a time to think about where we're going. So the fifth point is a tadarru' wa du'a. And that is, فَإِذَا مَسَّ الْإِنسَانِ دُرٌ دَعَانَا وَإِذَا مَسَّكُمُ الدُّرُّ فِي الْبَحْرِ ضَلَّ مَنْ تَدْعُونَهُ إِلَيْهِ إلا إياه بل إياه تدعون فيكشف ما تدعون إليه إن شاء قل من ينجيكم من الظلمات البحر والظلمات البر والبحر تَدْعُونَهُ تَضَرُّعًا وَخُفْيًا. So subhanAllah, this, you know, you get to make dua now. One is inaba, you have that thing, okay, I need to go towards Allah. And then the next thing is that you start having this, you know, deep thoughts, deep connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you start to knock the door of Rahman hada. And sometimes there is a khayr that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't answer our du'as so quickly. Where's the khayr? The khayr is if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't answer our du'as quickly, then we make more du'a. We seek His help more and more. And so as a result of seeking the help of Allah continuously, again and again and again and again, then we see that subhanAllah, we wake up and, you know, we develop ourselves. So subhanAllah, when you're dieting, you realize it's the mentality you need to change. Because if you're sitting at, let's say, you know, 300 pounds, and everyone, all the Australians are looking at me, everyone here's like in Australia, like looking at me like, what are you talking about pounds, kilograms? Okay, let's say 130, 140 Ks, you know, you're like a bit, you know, you're a bit big, but let's say you're tall, you know, if you're a bit shorter, then okay, we know it's a little bit more difficult to keep that weight, but let's say, you know, you've got a bit of height on you, you're this and that, but inshallah, let's say you're about that, and, or maybe 110 or 100 or whatever, but you know, you're in the three figure range, you know, there's three figures there, you know, as soon as you get to three figures, you know, no matter how high you are, you know, you're in the red there, you need to get back in the black, right? As they say, get back in the black. So your mentality is the mentality of someone who has the weight of three figures. So it's not going to benefit you to lose all the weight in 1 week. Everyone says, oh, I need to lose the weight. Bang, go back. Why? Because if you really want your weight to be long-lasting, you're not just losing weight for the sake of, you know, whatever, you know, for an occasion to wear, you know, particular clothes and, you know, this and that, and, you know, you want to look good for this wedding or for this walima or this aqiqah or, you know, jum'ah or, you know, Eid salah, you know, I'm going to wear my Eid clothes and whatever, you know, whatever complex you're in, right? Whatever you need to look good for, you know, the formal at the school or whatever it is. So, you know, you realize that you can lose the weight. Yeah, you can lose the weight. You can lose the weight in 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 1 month, some drastic, really unhealthy diet. That's really not going to benefit anyone, right? It's going to do more harm than good, but you will lose the weight, okay? But your mind, your mentality is still the mentality of someone who has a three-figure weight. So when you eat now, you get back, you bounce back so quickly. It's the mentality you need to change. And so with tadarru and dua, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you that problem. But what happens is that now with more dua, more dua, more dua, you start changing your mind from someone who looks at the problem as a problem to someone who looks at the problem as a benefit for the world. And so that's what's different. When you start looking at the problem as something that is a benefit for the world, or a benefit for yourself, it's a self-development. You know, I like the guys at the gym. I'm telling you, when I used to go gym, and I tell you, I like the gym. You know, it's like this place, you get there, you get sweaty, you work hard, you know, you come out, you feel like, I did something, you know? Or like when you run, and then you run around the block, come back, yeah, I ran around the block. You know, you feel like a physical exercise has got that, mashallah, it's got that beautiful thing. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam encouraged all of us to really have that, you know, nature of doing physical exercise. And, you know, I really, one thing I like about this, you know, a situation of everyone in lockdown is like when you drive around, you see so many people on the road walking and running. And you're like, okay, our country is going to come out like Olympic races after this situation. Inshallah, and Allah cure everyone that is sick. We don't want this pandemic to come, guys. But when it's there, we have to deal with it. And we have to make sure that we do it the right way. So, subhanAllah, then you realize what? You realize that your mentality needs to change. You know, as I was at a gym, I used to remember they used to have signs. Pain, the meaning of pain is that it is weakness leaving your body. It's like, Allah, Allah. Pain is weakness leaving your body. Allahu Akbar. What can you like? I'm like, okay. I was like, pushing. Okay, I'm like, well, is that 15 reps, man? I am going to push another 15 reps just because of that, right? Pain is weakness leaving your body. No pain, no gain. You know, stuff like that, it wakes you up. You know, and it gives you that, you know, that motivation. That's why I tell everyone, you really got to be motivated. Everyone at the top of the game is motivated. So tadarru and dua is going to motivate you. Making that tadarru and dua, turning towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, making dua is really going to change your life. The sixth point is al-hilm. And hilm means that it's a greater level to patience. You get hilm and then you get forbearance. And hilm is greater to patience, right? It's something that holds a person back, right? And it gives a, it's something of understanding, right? Hilm. And hilm, amman sadrat anhu al-musiba. It makes you like comfortable with the situation, right? And inna Ibrahim la awwahun haleem. Ibrahim was awwah. Awwah means to be very kind. And muni haleem is that he was very forbearant. So al-hilm amman sadrat anhu al-mushkila or al-musiba. Fabasharnahu bi-ghulamin haleem. And not only that, he was given basharat, he's haleem, and he was given basharat of a son that is also, you know, he was going to have a son, and that son was also at the same time going to be Halim as well. Inna fika khaslatayni yuhibbuhum Allah al-hilm wal anat. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to about Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam in Surah Safat that what? Inna fika khaslatayni yuhibbuhum Allah al-hilm, right? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves these two things, right? Sorry, this is not in Surah Safat, but this is a hadith of Muslim that inna fika khaslatayn yuhibbuhumullah al-hilm wal-anat, that these two things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves, you know, is one is hilm and the other one is anat, right? Which is to turn back towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَتَخْتَلِفُ مَرَاتِبُ الْحِلْمِ بِاخْتِلَافِ الْمَصَائِبِ فِي صِغْرِهَا وَكِبْرِهَا فَالْحِلْمُ عِنْدَ أَعْظَمِ الْمَصَائِبِ أَفْضَلُ مِنْ كُلِّ حِلْمٍ. And now, in terms of hilm, when it talks about forbearance, it's different amongst different people. Some people are more forbearant than others, right? There are some people, they are much more forbearant than others. So, the pious, when they are afflicted with something, they are very calm. And I've seen this, subhanAllah. You know, we نَحْنُ نَحْكُمُ بِالظَّوَاهِرِ وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِالسَّرَائِرِ. Allah knows who is really pious and who is not. But then you see it when something, you know, goes down. When there is a problem and that problem happens, that's when you really notice who's really got more piety. Because one thing is to perform salah. One thing is to, you know, it's to do all of the ordinances of Islam. Quran, dhikr, ibadah. Basically ibadah. But the other is that you show your piety in terms of your akhlaq. And so when things happen, you know, and they go wrong, and things, this is the dunya. The dunya is dunya. If something is going to go wrong, okay? If something's not going wrong, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they used to be, you know, when they were in good conditions, they used to look forward to the difficulty. And that's not for us. When we're in good conditions, we're just like, okay, ya Allah, keep it good as long as possible, right? But the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they were such that when the good conditions used to befall them, they would be like, okay, we need to, you know, they'll be like, no, we want like something, you know, to really, because they were like that. And they would always say that, subhanAllah, bulina bidarra'i fasabarna wa bulina bisarra'i wa falam nasbir, that we were tested with difficulty and we didn't have sabr. And we had sabr, we were tested with goodness and we couldn't have sabr. So goodness is like a type of difficulty that it's difficult in itself, right? It was like, it's in itself is something. But according to the different levels of the people will be forbearant in different ways. You know, how Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, Umar radiallahu anhu, Uthman radiallahu anhu, Ali radiallahu anhu, Talha bin Ubaidullah, Zubair bin Alawam, you know, Abu Baida bin Jarrah, Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the much more senior, the Jalili Qadri Sahaba, how they had hilm, you know, was something else, right? Sahaba in general, but the Jalili Qadri Sahaba, you know, the Ashr al-Mubashara, the Ashab Badr, the people of the Bayat al-Ridwan, the people of, you know, Uhud, the Sahaba who participated at all of these, you know, occasions with the Prophet ﷺ, the Fath-i Makki Sahabis, the people, Sahabis who were there when the Masjid of Medina was getting built, right? The Sahabis who were with the Prophet ﷺ in Dar Arqam, those people, their level of hilm was, you know, was like a mirror of the Prophet ﷺ. You know, so we need to, when we have hilm, we need to have it at the highest level. And when we do that, then subhanAllah, it's a type of intelligence. Okay, because the real intelligence, as you know, as the shuyukh say, subhanAllah, they say that subhanAllah, that you know, when you have that nature and you've turned back towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you receive peace. Ya ayyatuha an-nafsul mutma'inna irji'i ila rabbiki radiyatan mardiyah. فَادْخُلِي فِي عِبَادِي وَادْخُلِي جَنَّتِي. And the sabi'ah, the seventh one is الْعَفُ عَنْ جَانِيهَا. Right? الْعَفُ عَنْ جَانِيهَا. It's to forgive. And that's really difficult. You know, someone is openly, let's just put you in a situation. Someone openly campaigns against you. Everything they do, they wake up in the morning like, get that person, right? You know, everything that they do is, again, to forgive that person, it's the most difficult forgiveness, but that's where the reward is, right? And, you know, I'll tell you a story. It has an effect on you. Forgiving is a benefit. That's why it's mentioned here. It's a fadail, guys. It's a benefit. And I'll mention you a story. And, you know, we will wrap up with this story most likely. We might have one more point, inshallah. But this is, you know, it's going to take me time to get through this. But, you know, physically it has an effect of you, right? So let's read the full point, inshallah. Al-afud an janiha wal-afina an innas. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about the people who forgive others. And faman afa wa aslaha fa ajruhu ala Allah. The person who forgives and aslaha, who, you know, who makes peace with the other people. فَأَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. The person's ajr is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَالْعَفُ عَنْ أَعْظَمِهَا أَفْضَلُ مِنْ كُلِّ عَفُ. And forgiveness from, you know, from the highest levels of it is better than all, you know. وَالْعَفُ. So you, when you forgive the bigger problems, then you're going to go through more issues. So subhanAllah is an interesting story that the person, you know, I attended a conference and there was this, you know, doctor, Hernandez, I believe he was. Jimenez, Dr. Jimenez. Very amazing doctor from, you know, he uses chromotherapy, which is light therapy, and he uses a couple of other things to try and help patients. So he's based in San Diego, but I think his clinic is in Mexico. Very amazing person, mashallah. I had a really, really great time meeting him. And he was giving a talk, and he talked about, you know, the importance of, you know, he was a Muslim, guys. But subhanAllah, you can see even someone who's not Muslim, you don't need to be Muslim to recognize that not forgiving people has a physical effect on your body, right? And subhanAllah, this thing of forgiveness, if you don't do it, if you don't forgive the person who's doing something to you, or you don't forgive, sometimes they don't know they're doing it, guys. Okay, sometimes it is very purposeful, but most of the time, people just don't know they're ticking you off and annoying you. It's like, you know, they just wake up and I'm like, they got that, and then they have the right to look at you and say, what's wrong with you? Because, you know, you're totally annoyed with them. But then they look at you and they say, hey, you don't look right today. I don't look right. You're annoying me all the time. What are you talking about? Anyway, guys. So coming back to this point that, subhanAllah, so forgiveness has an effect. When you forgive, it really helps you help mentally, health, you know, health-wise, physical-wise, emotional-wise, everything. So there was this woman who was trying to help. He was trying to help cure her. And she was just not getting cured. And he tried and he tried and he tried and he tried again. And, you know, and then he said, no, there's something wrong here. So he spoke to her and he found out that, she was very old. She was 65 plus. And she happened to be, you know, okay, just guys, buckle up for this. You know, I know you're not ready for this. It's a little bit hard, but you need to hear it. She was raped, an incestual rape, by her father, by her brother, and her grandfather. And she's 65 years old. This is terrible. The people, whoever did this, this is terrible. You know, and whoever did this to her, they're all gone. They're all dead. And it's still having effect on her. And, you know, I did today, I was discussing in another halaqa, I was discussing about Andalus, right? The Muslims went to Spain because a woman got raped. We take these things very seriously. We don't take it lightly. We take these things very, very seriously. They were invited to Spain, and that's how Islam came into Spain, because a woman got raped, right? And she wasn't even Muslim, okay? So we take this thing, we respect women in general. But anyway, coming back to this point, that, you know, that subhanAllah, so she was suffering, and imagine, raped, incest raped as well. People at home, people who meant to be caregivers. And what happens is that she, you know, he told her, write a letter to these people. She wrote it and he said, burn it. And she burnt it. And as a result, subhanAllah, you know, she felt, you know, she wrote everything about what she didn't forgive and what she was, everything. And then she forgave. And as a result of forgiving, Dr. Jimenez says she immediately responded to the therapy and she got better. لا إله إلا هو الرحمن
القدوس السلام المؤمن المؤمن